And so because of this event then, it meant the beginning of the end of slavery. Yeah? How can you own a human being if that human being belongs to God? That makes sense? Slavery then becomes unthinkable. And so gradually, from this event, the implications get worked out, first within Judaism, where the whole condition of slaves has changed, and finally within Christianity, and finally with the abolition of slavery. Yeah? When people realize it's not possible to own another human being, because every human being belongs to God. It's God's, every human being is God's property, God's son, daughter. Does that make sense? So it took thousands of years from this event to gradually work through into now what we call human rights. When did the idea of human rights emerge? After the Second World War. Yes? 4,000 years later it's taken to get to this point. Yes? Where you can start to establish a kind of society that God wants, where people have the dignity of being his son or daughter. Make sense? So how about the mother's son? So this is, again, we go back to Adam and Eve. When she first gave birth, Eve said, this is what it says in English, "With the help of the Lord, I have acquired a man." And so she named her first son Cain. Okay? So in Hebrew, acquired is kenuti. So she named her son my possession. So what kind of a mother do you think Eve was? Very possessive, yes? Incredibly, she felt, this is my son. I own my son. That's why she gave him the name. Acquired, possession, yeah? He's mine. Okay, so this then had to be changed, this relationship between parents and children, where parents thought they owned their children, they could possess their children, they could use their children for their own purposes, they could decide what the children were going to do as a career, or as a job, and this, this, and this, and this. Parents thought they could control them. That had to be broken and changed. So when a person, so the responsibility of a parent then is to look after God's children. We have a duty to look after our children, not to control our children. We have a duty to look after God's children for him. We have a duty to make sure our children can fulfill their potential as the way that God would like them to support God's children to fulfill that potential. Now sometimes people, parents want to control their children, possess them. You know, this is the thing that happened until, you know, all these things, the echoes of this going on all the time. Yeah, there was a time, I remember when I was at school, there was a school teacher who was there with me, he was an art teacher, and got into a conversation with him, and he said, his father was a coal miner, worked out of mines. His grandfather a coal miner, his great-grandfather a coal miner, the whole family, they worked down the mines. But he wanted to go to university. Did his father want him to go to university? No. Okay? But he did. But of course, he moved from one place to another place, a different place. Yeah? And so sometimes that's the way parents are about possessing and controlling. And so all these sort of things need to be broken, such that, as father said, you know, parents want their children to be better than they are. Yeah? So that parents feel really proud, actually, my child is much better than me. Yes? This kind of idea. Okay, so that's the sort of way it's supposed to be. You have to think about Sarah. How do you think Sarah felt about the sacrifice of Isaac?
Unbearable.
You know, she's 90 years old when she gave birth to Isaac. She'd been waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting for decades. You know, it's unspeakable, unbearable to think. Imagine how she felt when God asked this. Maybe it's just why only Abraham went. I don't know. It's, you know, it's just an unimaginable kind of test that people went through, trying to change the way they related to each other. Yeah. So there's a nice little poem here by Khalil Gibran. It says, "Your children are not your children." Gibran is a Lebanese poet in the 20th century. Writes some beautiful poetry. Anyway, he said, "Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts. for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you. For life goes not backward, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children as living arrows are sent forth. The archer sees the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might, that his arrows may go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness, for even as he loves an arrow that flies, he loves also the bow that is stable. It's kind of vision for parents wanting their children to achieve much more than they've done themselves, wanting to support them, you know, in pursuing their path and their vision. And so this momentous event then, this binding of Isaac, then this became, you know, continued with the circumcision, yeah? The recognition that actually this child belongs to God. And then, and Jewish boys are circumcised on the eighth day, yes? What do we do on the eighth day when we have a child? Make a dedication ceremony, when we dedicate our children to God. And we go through a formal ceremony when we recognize, just as Abraham recognized this with Isaac, and just as Jewish boys are circumcised, we go through the same thing to recognize this is God's son, or this is God's daughter. We dedicate this child to God, and we make promises and vows that we're going to look after God's child and bring them up to the best of our ability that they can, you know, become God's true son and daughter. Does that make sense? So we go through the same thing that Abraham and Isaac went through, except just on a much milder way. Okay, so I'll take a break.